Call the meeting of the Conway Selectboard to order. First item on the agenda, the minutes for January 23rd. Has everybody reviewed the minutes? Any changes or additions?
No, it's good.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the 23rd.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, next item, meetings attended by select board members. I had a few, as usual.
We have all of them.
Yeah, right. So the capital equipment committee got canceled on Tuesday, so that was the capital improvement planning committee, so we didn't have that one. So that'll have to get rescheduled. And on Thursday, I went to an interesting meeting called the Small Town Summit, which I will give you this if you're interested, but it's basically a group that meets to look at special issues of small towns and to look at legislative changes or legislation they would like to propose, and that was good. And Adam Hines came to that meeting, so that was the first time I've been in a meeting here in Western Mass with him. And he's very busy in the eastern part of the state, and I guess I would say it's this last week, and this morning we had a housing committee meeting. Those are my meetings.
Okay, great. Do we have any citizens' concerns?
Okay, we have no citizens' concerns. Old business. I understand the housing committee is going to table. You're going to table what you have for tonight?
I'd like to explain why. Okay?
Sure.
Okay. So I'm here with Ellen Lamastro, who's on the housing committee. Donna Crabtree was not able to attend. So as you know, the last time we were before you, we had requested that you sign that intent to offer for the property on 201 Maple, which is the home and the barn owned by the Sheehan Robertsons. The Sheehan Robertsons have requested an amendment to one of the addendums, one of the contingencies. And what they're asking for is that we perk at our own expense, perk in certain locations to avoid gardens. And the third one, I'm blanking, is that we restore the property fully. Okay? And those are very reasonable requests. But since that time, those days that have passed, you know, we're feeling like we need to reflect on two things in particular. One is that we have not felt good about having an inclusive and accessible way to communicate with the abutters and other concerned citizens in town. We feel that a town project of this scale really requires that. Secondly, that we're realizing we're kind of at a new stage with the committee in that we're now seeking non-town-owned property. Up until this point, we've always said that town-owned land was our first priority, but this is a new domain for us. So it's leaving us with some important questions around, what if another parcel comes up for sale tomorrow? How can we quickly, on sudden notice, be able to buy something without all these processes? There's got to be an answer, but we don't have that answer right now. There's been a concern about the 5-acre minimum or not. That's starting to get resolved. How can we reassure, this keeps coming up, how can we reassure the residents that we can give Conway preference, Conway residents and those that work here? So we feel like we need a little more time to, get these answers succinct. So we're here to acknowledge that the select board has agreed to sign the intent to purchase. And that agreement would go through if this amended addendum was signed. But we're asking that you not sign it at this time in order for us to help, develop this more effective, more accessible communication and to answer those bigger questions. So during that time, we also have asked the Sheehan Robertsons if we could perk their property without that intent to purchase. And to also, we want to perk the Matis property as well. In order to demonstrate, the additional due diligence that we've done.
As you know, I discovered that I may have a potential conflict of interest. So I have recused myself from any discussion, deliberation, or decisions on this matter. So I will hand it over to Bob.
Yep, that's fine.
So, do you have a time frame, any chance?
Well, the original intent to purchase brings us to the end of February. I'm hoping that within like a few weeks, we can get these other pieces together. I've already talked to Tom about just making our webpage more robust, how to answer these questions, and how the answers could be public. And then, you know, as we speak, we're, you know, shooting ideas back and forth about how we can get clarity on those others. So I think we could do it within 2 weeks. That's our hope.
Any further questions about
it? No. Bob, I have one concerning the original ISL, or whatever that first agreement was. It said that we would use a variance process to put in this development. I checked with town council, and he says we most likely need a bylaw change.
Okay.
So I'm concerned about the timing.
Okay.
I guess the question in my mind is, should we ask for a special town meeting to change the bylaw, or should we wait until May, regular annual town meeting? Then it usually takes, I think the state allows themselves 3 months to approve it. Now, it does go retroactive back to town meeting, but there would be this 3-month gray period if we do it at annual town meeting. So I don't know if that's another concern we should think about addressing.
Well, I think we should, myself personally, I think we should hold on right now as they get more information to find out what real direction they might be wanting to head in.
Right, because if the perk test fails, it's all a moot point mm-hmm. for this particular parcel. That's why we're trying to get that done as soon as possible.
Do you guys
feel about
it? What's driving the bylaw change?
It's my understanding a town is required to comply with its own bylaw for development like this. And currently, we don't allow anything beyond a duplex
uh-huh.
on a parcel. So we would have to. This would be called the planned development, so that in theory, you could take multiple acres of land and then put houses closer together, create some open space. I believe Pixie's asked us to look at age-restricted housing. There's some requirements that go with that if you're going to have a development that meets the state requirements for over 55 or over 62.
Would that bylaw, Joe, be on a case-by-case?
No, it would be a general bylaw for the town. It would apply to anybody who came along if a private developer wanted to tackle something like this.
So that's different than the group of houses behind the bank?
That is all on 4-acre lots. That's basically, it's a similar, I think the end product will look similar, but the area behind the bank, Parsons Farm, is all 4-acre parcels with a common driveway. And I don't believe we want to put 4-acre parcels for senior housing, so you might want to put all the houses on 4 acres, like in this situation.
So if that bylaw was to go into effect, you would open it up for anybody in town anyway?
Good, right. If someone else wanted to do a similar development.
Yeah, I was going to say, does that equal accepting subdivision control?
No, it's a planned development.
It
wouldn't necessarily be a subdivision. Subdivisions where you cut it up into 1 acre lot.
Right.
So this would be a...
Okay, this is a separate...
A planned development. There might be 3 or 4 houses on mm-hmm. 3 or 4 acres, but they would be closer together.
Mm-hmm.
The land wouldn't have to be divided into parcels.
Because mm-hmm. Conway has never accepted subdivision control, right.
No,
so this would not be a change of that.
We would still not allow subdivision.
Has there been some discussion? I mean, I imagine there has been.
Sure, can I ask you your name, please?
Absolutely. It's Emmett Vandresh, and I live down in Pumpkin Hollow. Has there been some discussion about the walkability of that site? Because it's pretty steep and quite icy, actually. There's water that drains onto the road mm-hmm. right at the base of Academy Hill Road there, sort of in all directions getting to town. So I'm wondering, I don't know, is there some consideration if the intent is to have it be for seniors, it seems like it's maybe not so senior friendly as other locations might be. I understand that it's for sale, so that's an enticing thing.
So Emmett, we don't anticipate people walking to town from that distance,
okay.
but we do anticipate them driving to town, and we don't.
Sure.
We do think there's some alternatives to that, because that's come up as well. We would like to see people be able to walk for reflection and recreation.
Sure.
But we're pretty excited by how relatively flat that piece of land is.
Mm.
That was attractive to us, having seen very little that was flat.
Okay.
Yeah. But thanks for the consideration.
Sure.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Conway is not much flat, man.
No.
Anywhere in the...
Certainly. No.
And then, as you've seen, it's created a huge stumble block for these people because, and there's not very many parcels of land that are open for anything like this.
To answer that question, I don't recall ever seeing walkability addressed in any of these bylaws. I'll look again specifically, but.
Because it seems like
up to the developer to make sure he's walkable.
No, I guess so, but it seems like if the intent is to best serve seniors, then having it be walkable to Bakers and fairly flat seems like it. I understand that there's limited supply and all that, but
flat and common.
Well, no, but there is. I mean, there is sort of a central area down in the center of town where.
And it's occupied.
I understand.
Unfortunately, too, there is a very, very limited supply of land near the center of town.
Sure.
And so it forces you to work your way out further and further, sure, further away from the center of county, so further away from your post office and stuff like that.
Right.
Bob, I have a question for you. Will Cody on Maple Street. So the center of town becomes an active part of this inquiry in my mind because it seems that the wastewater treatment project that has been proposed, mm-hmm, it really holds the future of the center of the town in balance. It's my understanding that so it's my understanding.
Oh, my word.
The way I've gotten rid of them, Bob, is if you turn the lights off in this room, yeah, they'll go into the hallway.
So you ready for this?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ready?
Where's the other light?
The other one's over
here.
It's on that side.
He
won't bother us.
Hey, y'all.
Now it's going to turn on the zombie light, man. Tom's out there, he's brave.
Any more visitors?
Most exciting part of the meeting.
Yeah, I don't know.
Hope you got that on camera.
Okay, well, go ahead.
Get the voice here about fast getting caught in the air. He's got a big beard.
Sorry for the interruption.
I
everything
you have in your mouth
is probably in the hallway.
Oh, yeah. I just love that the solution was right at hand, like your experience with this guy.
Yeah.
No kidding. Yeah, so the question really is, and I apologize, I haven't been in touch with this piece of it, but what's the status of wastewater treatment for the center of town? And, you know, if it's stalled at this point, is there intention? Is there motivation?
That's the right question.
Why are you guys picking on
Tom? Take
it would be really great if everybody got all of these questions to the housing committee. One of the things that we're working on is getting a series of questions and answers, mm-hmm, rather than try to deal with them at this meeting. If you can get all your questions, we've already got a lot of questions, and we need to get all of the questions that people have in. So if you can get those to Pixie, we can address them. As she said, we're going to get them up on the website.
Will has been very helpful asking very good questions that he helps me reflect what other people need.
Yeah, absolutely. We need all the questions. But rather than trying to answer them now, if we can get them to Pixie, then we'll get answers up on the website over the next couple of weeks. Everybody will have the same answers, and everybody will be looking at the same.
I've stated that, and so Pixie has that one. I think, you know, at this point, it's important to me that the question is asked in a more broad way, that it's not just what applies to housing, but, you know, for me, the way I look at it, Tom, and members of the board, is that if that's your commercial district, and your zoning says that commercial development has to happen in that district, but yet it can't happen because we don't have an active wastewater treatment solution, then you're asking a potential developer to do something he can't do in an area where he can't do it. So the gaze is always going to look out beyond the existing zoning laws. And I see that as a danger for Conway. So if I were to look at this as a piece of what we're talking about here, that the wastewater treatment for the center of town needs to be attended to. There are other benefits for that, the center of town with the aside of the senior project, but the senior project would then have additional options there.
It would help greatly to get all of these questions in writing into the housing committee so we can address them thoroughly.
Okay.
Anybody else have any questions? No, Bob?
No.
Okay, I guess, thank you everybody for showing up.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your interest in the projects, and we're looking forward to talking to you all later.
Okay, thank you.
John, thank you.
No idea.
The next item on our agenda is scheduled for 6:30, so what we'll do a couple of things before that.
If I could go, I'm prepared to go over all of the budget items with you guys before the final.
You want to do that before they get here?
Well, I could, or we could do everything else, which was fine with me too.
All right, why don't we wait for the finance committee? Let's do your update.
Okay, well, I'm going to let my update over in the other office. I'm so sorry about that. Sorry, I'll send something out.
Joe, did you go grab Will on his way out?
Grab him?
Well.
Joe, you're leaving?
Yes. Would you want me to stay?
Well, I don't know. I thought you were here for something more than you know, just family.
Oh, okay. All right. I thought there were going to be more questions.
Okay. All right, why don't we go over to Joe
and get him on the committee,
the budgets.
Yeah.
Right now. We're just going to go over the budgets quickly with Tom,
okay,
before finance gets it ready.
I wanted to say a few things. For the audit, the $13,000 that we've been doing annually will not be enough to do a biannual audit. We have to bump that up by $1,500 or $2,000 because they have to do extra work if they haven't done the year before. They essentially have to do a mini audit of the year before. And so we have an estimate from the company we're using now.
How much?
Again, it's going to be somewhere between $14,500 and $15,000. Again, much cheaper than doing it annually, but they do require a little bit of money. We got a fairly sharply worded note from them about how much they were required to do for what they had bid, because what they had bid was based on doing it annually. So if we want to do it biennially, we'd still have to bump it up a little bit. So I wanted to make that.
This $13,000 figure is for the annually done?
Yes. Yes. And eventually, after we've had this company for somewhere between 5 and 7 years, which we're coming up on, I'd like to look at moving to another auditor for 5 to 7 years. It's generally considered good practice because they have different ways of looking at things. Mm-hmm. And it's good to shake things up a little bit every once in a while. Not too often, because you want them to be familiar with your books most of the time. But and that's why you give a longer contract. You may remember at the last town meeting, the select board got the power to enter into a 5-year contract for the purposes of an audit. So at some point, I think that would be a good thing.
So are we doing an audit this year?
We did one for 16, so yeah. We're not scheduled to do one for 17, which is why it's blank under requested. I don't know whether to ask for nothing or, again, it's the recommendation of both the treasurer and myself that we do an annual audit because it's a best financial practice. Mm-hmm. It's not as important as it would be in a larger town.
Next year's budget is 18.
And we who are responsible for the town's finances feel most comfortable when we have most backup in what we're doing.
Am I correct, John? Town meeting asked me about this $13,000 fiscal year 2017. That money, that $13,000, is sitting in that account right now, correct?
Yes.
But we're not doing an audit this year.
Well, we haven't signed it.
I see.
Correct, John?
Yeah. Our plan was to do one for this year and not do one for fiscal year 16. But because we did the borrowing for the fire truck, we were required to have a current audit. So we had to go back and get that done. Oh, I'm sorry, we actually...
Or was that expended?
I believe we used that money in fiscal year 17 for the fiscal year 16 audit. Yes, and then we had to add $2,500 for a special audit at the Conway Grammar School.
So the account is empty now?
Yeah. We have expended that $13,000. I have an extra handout for employee benefits. The major thing is that health costs went up, and the major driver of that is pharmaceuticals. They made a change for the first time between raising the maybe for the first time, it certainly wasn't expected this year, between the HMO plan and the PPO plan, the basic plan and the extended plan. And that's based on a couple of things. One of them is, frankly, discouraging the use of the PPO because it is a more expensive plan. But some people do need it, so they didn't put it up too much more. Also, in future years, they will be looking at, for both plans, higher co-pays rather than raising the deductible. That's the way that most of the treasurers of the towns in Franklin County feel that we ought to address rising costs. So rather than a higher deductible, raising co-pays on services. I wanted especially to mention that everybody's taking this real big increase in costs very seriously. The other thing is obviously under my own, I have the salary under negotiation. I will have to budget conservatively for that if we don't have an agreement. By the way, I'll put my budget out in the third week in February.
We will have it.
Well, I'm sure we'll have a counter offer. With any luck, we'll have an agreement. And Lee will be in to talk about. Lee is in to talk about the assessors. Gemma will be in at 7 to talk about the ambulance, just so you know. And I will cover the items for the audit and employee benefits when the finance committee comes in. My own budget, the legal budget, the dog officer, the tree warden. Ginny will be in for the clerk. And I wanted to mention that that's another bump in her salary. I had planned a 2-year rise in her salary because I knew it would be difficult to absorb it in 1 year. But this brings her up to the benchmark of last year that Don Jacobs found, which is sort of the midpoint of what her, taking into account the comparable towns and responsibilities she has and her experience, that's the benchmark. It's not even the maximum amount for her range that she could be earning, but this does bring her up to that benchmark based on 30 hours a week. So that's, I think, only fair. And again, in preparation for advertising this, you'll notice there's also an hourly under here for the first time. That's for an assistant, and we're hoping that it will be somebody who can take over for her when her term ends. So somebody's coming in anyway for some backup to learn how our system works, learn how everything is, so that we have somebody who knows everything that is needed to know, which is an incredible amount.
But that was only like 4 hours a week?
Yes, it's a let's see. Yes, it's a very small amount per week. Five hours a week, that's what it is. At $15 an hour.
I like the idea of training somebody. But,
yes.
But 5 hours a week isn't much. I mean, can we just pay her overtime for 5 hours a week?
Pay who?
Ginny.
It's not a question of paying Ginny, it's a question of training someone else to know what's going on. So that would be a separate hourly line item instead of the salary item. You'll note there's she put a lot of work into constructing the discussion of her position and what it takes. So I would urge you all to read that carefully and understand that she actually does have an extremely responsible position in town. There are a number of things that only the town clerk can do, and it does require in-depth knowledge of state law and procedure in a number of different areas. So, again, bringing it up to something where somebody will actually take it as a position is my main concern here. There's the historical amount we paid, and then there's what somebody in their right mind would actually take to do the job. So, because it is an awful lot of work. So I didn't want to mention all those things just as a preface to the meeting on with the Finance Committee, who has started arriving in droves.
Jim, are you expecting more of your committee?
Well, that'll do for now. Well, I see. I've got to hand this out. Let's see if they're getting hung up.
Tom, under the assessors, you call it salary, but you refer to it as stipend, but it's really the same thing?
It's a set amount for an exempt employee. So, it should really read salary because, well, I guess the reason it's a stipend is because she's an elected official. So
the board members receive a stipend. Here's the new copy of send that out.
Oh,
take one.
I'm sorry, you're talking about the assessor's gift.
Yeah.
And Jim, this is additional
updated.
In the text, he refers to it as the assessor's stipend.
So
right. That's different from salary.
Up here it lists. What he said about it seems to correspond to the word salary. It's kind of a fuzzy.
Where is that included in here?
I'll answer it when the time on the time comes. Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yep.
Good.
Let's see, what can I have?
Oh, and
get the DA update?
I do have an update, but I only have one copy, so I'll just read that while we're waiting for the other finance committees to come in. For department news, I am very pleased to announce that Conway has gotten a proposed 6.9% increase in unrestricted general government aid. That's the cherry sheet money we get. It's unrestricted, along with a very slight decrease in our state assessments or charges. This is a total increase of about $71,119 over last year, which is just extraordinary. The average increase in unrestricted general government aid across the Commonwealth was 3.9%, and we got 6.9%. Even if this is adjusted through the legislative process, it is good news for our fiscal year 2018 budget. We made the transition to a new phone system over the weekend with only minor glitches. What happened to your call, notwithstanding?
I don't know. It might not have been a conversation. I was in another phone conversation today, anyway.
I expect it will be substantially less expensive and that we will have excellent customer service. There is a new menu, but everyone has their old extension, except Ron, who now has his internal extension 10 instead of his, as his external extension as well. He was the pound sign before, but the pound sign is now a functional.
He has an external extension in the town garage?
Yeah, 10. Oh. If you press 10, you get connected to the highway department.
In the office.
In the office one.
If you call in from the outside. We will be refining the outgoing message over the next couple of days, but it's 99.9% functional right now, which is great. Good work for Roy Cohen, our IT fellow, over the weekend. I have consulted with Joe Colucci about next steps for the problem dogs on Graves Road. I'd like to schedule a nuisance dog hearing in 2 or 3 weeks, probably at a regular select board meeting with all stakeholders invited. And I'll work with John on scheduling that. In other news, Eversource will be doing some transmission work in Conway. The work will entail replacing 2 existing lattice structures with 2 weather steel pole structures. The impacted street in Conway is Bardswell Ferry Road. The work is expected to begin March 1st, 2017 and continue through August 2017. Uh-huh. And we can contact Eversource if we have any questions about that. But it's a long, they'll be out there for a while. So I thought I'd mention it. And that's...
Is this on the High Line or what is it?
Yeah, it's the lattice, it's the transmission lines going through over Bardswell Ferry Road. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, thank you, Tom.
That's what I've got there.
All right, we'll start on your session.
Okay, yeah, often, members arrive.
Okay.
15 minutes after the.
All right. First item is the. You want to run through this? Finance,
sure.
The Finance Committee budget.
I thought we could take care of the Finance Committee budget and the reserve fund at the beginning, not anticipating much change in either. I don't know what your initial thoughts on that are, but.
It's not something that we've really discussed yet. So
let's put that off till you get your members here and see if there's any reason anybody has for raising or lowering either one of them. For the audit, the treasurer and I, being officials in the town responsible for the town's finances, will always recommend an annual audit as the best practice. Many small towns don't have it. We haven't had an annual audit for quite a while. It's usually been biennial or even longer than that. I wouldn't want to see it any less frequently than biennial. And we have spent our 2017 money on a fiscal year 2016 audit. And we had to add to that for a 3-year audit of the school. That's a quickie, it's a $2,500 item. If we do skip a year, we should add somewhere between $1,500 and $2,000 because they have to do a little bit of a mini audit on the year that they haven't audited in order to make sure that they have the right numbers going forward into the fiscal year they're actually auditing. So instead of, the request is either going to be for zero or for $14,500 or $15,000. And I realize that even though the staff would like the protection of an annual audit, that it might not be something that the town thinks it needs to pay for. So, I understand that.
How have the votes gone on that in the past? Have people not wanted to vote one for every year?
People being...
In town meeting.
I mean, town meeting does what, usually pretty much takes what Finance Committee and Select Board recommends, you know, straight down Article 2. There's very few changes there.
Yeah.
You know, and we've been doing, like Tom said, we haven't been doing an audit every year, so, you know. I mean, we'll vote. I don't know that we voted on where we stand on it, but, you know, personally, I don't seem to change that every 2 years. Right?
All right, so Finance wants to stay with 2 years?
Well, Jim Bosman wants to stay with 2 years. Okay. Yeah, yeah. Taking a vote on it. You know?
Yeah, okay. What's the feeling of the rest of your committee?
I just found out about it, John. You might have to ponder it a few minutes.
Okay.
What are
we talking about?
Ponder or ponder? It was an
audit. Every year. Tom is recommending an audit every year for best practices, for financial best practices. In the past, our practice has been every 2 years. But as things get more complicated as time goes by, and as you know, the state requires more and more of us in terms of reporting, may be a good idea to do that every year. And certainly, you know, again, for best practices, that's certainly the way to do it.
If we did do any borrowing in fiscal year 18, we would have to have a fiscal year 2017 audit, and a current audit. And that would mean that we would have to find funding for it, which we would either do through the borrowing process, or we would have to find it in the reserve fund.
What's the, isn't, even though I know that in absolute dollars, and do it on it every year, adds up to more than once every 2 years, but you're still not saving half the money, because doing an audit every 2 years, it's a lot more work.
Well, it could be $1,500 to $2,000 more work.
Yeah, that's spread out over a 2 year period.
For the auditor. So instead of, if we skipped a year, instead of it costing $13,000, it would cost $14,500 or $15,000. We should budget.
That's all?
Yeah. It's a minimal check to make sure that the numbers from 1 year to the next are correct. And it doesn't go down deep into the budget at all. It's very, very top level, making sure the numbers add up.
Doesn't that happen anyways?
Well, in a normal audit, you go pretty deep down into the budget and make sure all the numbers within the budget added up properly.
No, but like you're saying, in general, that they all add up. I mean, the state certifies free cash. I mean, there is all kinds of things that, if it's not right, it's going to be obvious. I mean, how's the town been functioning doing it every other year? It seems like, you know, we don't have to go for overrides and stuff like that. It seems like we're not quite as pinched as the different towns around. I'm just wondering what's, so 26,000 in 2 years or 15,000 in 2 years?
But you're saying it's not the same. You're saying that an annual audit puts much greater control? Would they have, is there anything on any of this that relates to the school budgets, auditing of school budgets, or is that totally a separate issue?
The school does its own audits.
Yeah. The school does its own audits.
I mean, yeah.
Not an internal audit. They have an outside party that comes in and audits.
Yes.
So explain, so for borrowing purposes,
we would have to have a current year budget.
So we have a current one for this year because we borrowed for the fire truck.
No, that's right. Last year's. We have not had a 17 times. Right, Tom?
Well, we can't have a 17 audit until the books are closed.
Right.
in July.
But we would have to have a 17 audit if we voted to borrow in May for any project.
What do other comparable towns do?
A lot of them do every other year. I don't hold the position very strongly. It's just that I feel like I have to recommend it because it is a best practice.
Best practice.
And you guys should want to be sure that all of your money is being spent properly. It's a mark of faith that you have allowed it to be every other year, and that's great.
Well, if they can't chase, so what happens if they have to chase down a rabbit hole somewhere in that in the year of the audit, they find maybe there was a, well, here's the thing. See, these days we have regular accounting, right? We have books that are looked at every single month, every week for that matter, correct? And in theory, that should take care of it, in theory. I'm not saying that you don't need an audit. You do need an audit, but do you need it every year? I mean, I don't have a good answer.
Internally, we have very good financial controls.
Yes.
Jan, our treasurer, worked very hard after the last financial management review by the Department of Revenue to make sure that our financial controls were up to speed, and they absolutely are now. But that's internal functioning. The audit gives you external confirmation that your internal controls are working.
Well, the most recent audit that we have, whether in the management, was there a management discussion and analysis letter from the firm that did the audit?
Absolutely, and we had no major deficiencies.
Okay. All right.
When do we make the decision of whether to audit 2017?
Well, we have to do it now.
We have to get it in the budget for. So if we do it, then we need to put $13,000 in for 2018. And if we don't do it, then we need to put in $15,000.
Right.
For
2019. For 2019.
We wouldn't we wouldn't do it at all for 2018.
Right. So I think on this topic, I mean, you know, we're pretty early in the budget process.
Exactly.
So the finance committee is going to discuss this further.
Yes.
We'll take Tom's position under advisement, and you know, we'll make a recommendation when we present our, you know, once we get all the numbers. I mean, we've got some people here who are looking to present some new numbers. You know?
Sure.
So.
All right, let's move on.
I have some notes on employee benefits. I did hand out an extra sheet to you, which we just got from the Franklin Regional Retirement Board, which explains why Franklin County retirement has jumped $10,000. The short answer, which is also extraordinarily accurate, is that people are living longer. So, since people are living longer, they have to plan for giving out more money in retirement. So to meet their goals and their requirements by what they've promised people, they have to raise the assessments. And all the details are in the sheet, the three sheets that I handed out. And I don't think we particularly have time to go through all those details, but I didn't want to let you know that that's one of the major reasons that employee benefits is going up so much. The other reason that it's going up so much is because of group health insurance, which is quite large. It's 43.7, really. And that's due to the, you remember last year's increases were 6.8% raises in cost, and this year they're split between 9.4 for HMO plans and 10.8 for the extended PPO plans. Some people do have to get PPO plans. They're the plan you get if you expect that you might be using a doctor who's out of your service area. And so anyone who has a student who's studying elsewhere as a dependent and is on their health plan would be in that situation. And aside from that, you know, the cost of pharmaceuticals is also rising. And that's being planned for over several years. Just so you know, it is being addressed. The retirement system is looking at raising co-pays in both plans rather than raising the deductible. The treasurers in the towns of Franklin County have decided as a whole that they would rather see larger co-pays for services than larger deductibles. They feel that's a better service to the employees. So that's a little bit of a note for future years. The co-pays will be going up. But for this year, there's a big bump. And a lot of it is because people are living longer. And they've had to adjust their internal forecasting for that, and therefore they have to raise their rates.
All right, there isn't much we can do about this particular budget. You know, we're kind of captive to what goes on with the retirement system as well as the group insurance.
So next is
the assessor's budget.
Okay. I just handed out, it's in small print, I'm sorry, I wanted to get it on one page, the answering the questions that Tom
asked. Small print so we can't see the numbers.
No, you can see the numbers. If you look at the numbers.
They look small.
As long as they shrunk, we don't care.
Yeah. If you look at the numbers, based on the current year's salary, we would ask for an increase of about $450 in our total budget. In other words, a flat level budget. Mm-hmm. You know, going down through the notes a little bit to help explain things, I did it line by line. Under assessor's salary, it's called assessor's salary, on the accountant's line, but it's actually the board members' stipends, and which are $1,400 per member per year, and that's in recognition of the hours that are put in with our meetings, with attending educational programs, and we've always included the site work for new growth in that also. So that's not paid on a salary basis at all. Those items are recognized in the annual stipend.
And it hasn't changed in 5 years.
It hasn't changed in 5 years. We're not asking for a change on it. Under clerical, basically we're requesting the same number of hours in the same categories. If you look down partway, there's another little square that shows our clerk's hours, 19 hours a week, her current pay rate. Malcolm has been going out 2 to 3 hours a week. He didn't this fall because of health reasons, but keeping us up on our cyclical inspections. In other words, getting around to different parts of town, verifying the data on our cards, taking new pictures, this type of thing. We are obliged to have a cyclical reinspection of all the properties over an 8-year period. So we take one section of town each year and we do that. And then mine is my administrative hours. I've actually dropped that down to 23 for next year. And then we have another category that, which is where we take out mileage from using our own vehicles for site visits around town, to go to meetings, that type of thing. Or if Russ comes out with us, you know, on... It's basically picking up.
So you basically what you're saying is basically Malcolm's difference that's increased it. He didn't do that the year before?
No, he did do it. We had about the same amount calculated.
Well, I guess...
And
you're lowering your hours and upping the dollar amount.
Well, that's my current rate.
the total budget for that item is
the
up.
The total budget for that item is up slightly. It's up, what, $400?
I question. But that doesn't take into consideration if we give an overall across-the-board percentage increase for wages.
That's correct.
So why isn't that item, why isn't that item staying the same?
I probably had 22 hours last year. I don't rightly recall.
All right, well, anyway, we've got the detail here on what makes up the request. That's helpful.
Yeah.
I don't know if we have a handout like this from last year, we can look back and see.
I didn't bring mine.
If there was
last
that level
year,
of detail last year, I don't know if we're going to be able to pick it up.
Right.
That level of detail for
$400.
Right. But I think here I've provided enough information that you can compare it in detail and ask any other questions you might have.
You said you decreased your hours, some you think, for this next year?
Yes, but that's going to be in a different category.
Different than the wages?
Yep. Yep, I'll talk about that in a second. As we go down the line items in our budget, deeds and plans, $25 a year covers that very nicely. We don't need to change that. We have no need to change our postage, $25. We currently have a good supply on hand. Dues are expected to stay the same level for our professional organizations, which are the Franklin County Assessors Association and the State Assessors Association. Tuition and meetings, $400, that's down $100 from last year. Some of them now don't charge as much, and quite frankly, if they don't have a topic of interest to us, we don't go. You know, no sense paying to go to something that's much more pertinent to cities. Under office supplies, we have enough there to pay for two sets of toner for our printer and two for the copier, the new copier, and plus another $50 for odd small items, although we don't need anything in particular. Mm-hmm. Under equipment repair, the assessors pay the annual maintenance contract for the copier scanner that's in the office. The Board of Health bought it, so they took on the initial major cost. We pay the annual maintenance cost. Actually, with the new copier, it's come down, which is kind of neat. Yeah, it was $600 a year. We're now at $535. And our color printer is still holding up very, very well. It's getting older now, but it's behaving beautifully. If it were to fail, it would need to be replaced rather than repaired. It would be obsolete. And what time we have our IT technicians pay through the technology budget, we don't have to cover that in our assessor's budget. Mm-hmm. Under software support, the GIS program is still $400 a year as it has been. Software Consortium, which is our valuation program through the Department of Revenue, will be $2,850 for FY17. Plus, we have a town assessment because Jan also uses it for the tax collector. So we split that. And that's what, 2 times 4 is 462. Okay, $925. And so we each pay half of that. Tax map maintenance, the annual bill is for the maintenance updates because of property changes, splits, anything like that. Adding buildings is $1,200, and that stayed the same. And $1,800 for the GIS website maintenance and upgrades. And that's an ongoing project. We don't pay any extra hourly fees on that. And they are very responsive about getting things up. Very good to work with. We added another $100 to that for making another couple of sets of large maps. The big ones that we like to have in the offices. Okay, next one is clerical, and we kind of touched on that already. Equipment repair. Our new computer was new in 2014, and all the other office equipment is doing fine. So we don't expect to need anything there. So we left that at 750. Property revaluation. Prior to this, the Department of Revenue had everyone on a 3-year cycle where the towns had to do a complete revaluation recertification every 3 years. Under the Municipal Modernization Act, they've upped that period to 5 years, which is nice. We still have to look at things every year, but that's done in-house. We don't have to pay anyone outside to do it. We don't have to pay for the big appraisal for the hydroelectric plant every 3 years. Now, that'll be every 5 years. In the past, we've put $7,500 a year aside toward the next recertification revaluation. We can now lower that to $5,000 a year and be fully prepared financially for the next revaluation when it comes in 2022. And that's just an ongoing annual.
Is that money set aside?
Yes.
3 years?
Yes. It's in a warrant article, so it's a running account that carries through toward the next revaluation.
That's why it's listed under warrant article.
Right. That's a separate article up here. It's at the bottom of the chart at the top.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You can see where that was, $7,500.
Yep.
Now,
so it was 7,500 times for 2 out of 3 years, 15,000.
For 3 years.
By 3 years was 5,000. Or 7,500.
It was 7,500 a year, basically.
So that's 21.5.
Mm-hmm.
And so now you're going to do 5,000.
We'll have 25,000.
25.
Right. Because it may be a slightly bigger project, and by then the appraisal for the hydro plant may cost a little more.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that's left over would carry forward.
Mm-hmm.
At some point, it's not going to be allowed to develop a slush fund, so to speak. At some point, we could simply say, okay, we are, some money has been saved. Let's release this much back into the general fund if we need to, if we see that opportunity.
So we've just completed the...
We've just completed the revaluation, yep. 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 Now, software support. We have, since 2003, used the valuation program supported and sponsored by the Department of Revenue.
Mm-hmm.
It has been a wonderful program. It has been an excellent value for the money. It has cost about $1,500 a year with unlimited support. It's just been marvelous. It's a flexible program. It has opportunities for local use, if you want to put in something to track something, whatever. However, the Department of Revenue is letting go of that program. And the 75 towns that had been part of it, I've had to go looking for something else. In continued support, the Department of Revenue set up a mass IT office with a couple of personnel to help all the towns in this program shift to another valuation program. They also researched programs and have selected one from Tyler Technologies as one that they would recommend. If the small towns accept the Tyler Technologies program, the state will pay the conversion costs for us. And that is a huge help. I've looked at the program. Jan has looked at it. We also have the option to go independent and hire an outside vendor. The most common ones are Patriot Properties and Vision. The appraisal systems. There are others. We've looked at them. They are much more expensive. Right now, Sunderland, I was checking with them because I had worked over there several years ago. Patriot's $5,800 a year, plus they pay Mayflower another $15,500. So they're paying essentially $20,000 a year, where we've been paying $1,500. and having accomplishing the same thing. It's been nice. However, the Tyler Technologies is going to be slightly more expensive. The state is underwriting our first year with them. We would have to continue our old program over the new one for one solid year in order to give us time to double check, to make sure every single account, every drawing, whatever, has gone over successfully to the new program. I'm including some hours, extra hours there for me to be doing that work outside of my regular office work. Okay. The new program, the shift will probably happen in fiscal 19. And so we would start paying for the new program in fiscal 20. The price that's already been negotiated is $3,775 a year. And they've negotiated a contract for fiscal 20 through 22. So fiscal 20 is when we would have to start paying that, but we would also have stopped paying our state one at that time. So the differential would come along 3 years, 2 years from now, and is able to be predicted, and is probably less than $3,000 a year.
And that would include support? That would
yes.
Be...
Yes. That includes telephone and sign-in support from them. The conversion is going to include training hours, training sessions, and some in-house help, as well as from a distance, you know, VPN type stuff. Yeah.
And the state is picking up the tab for
the
that.
State is picking up the tab for that for the first year, which is
well, hopefully the conversion is done. Yeah. It's a one-time
thing. Yes, yes, it is.
Until you move to some other software.
Right. Some, but I think almost all the towns now. Well, over, I think 45 signed up to go to Tyler Technologies that I knew of a month or so ago. And some of the others are going to different programs.
If they're
going
to go out on their own, that seems crazy to me.
Well,
I assume the state negotiated a pretty good deal.
They did. And we had chances to, we went to presentations by several different vendors. That the state had come in and do presentations down in Springfield for us, demonstrating their programs, talking about what their support and training would be. In addition to doing a couple of webinars online for companies that couldn't come. And I certainly felt that Tyler was a very, very good fit. It's very like our present program in many ways. It also has the adaptability that we have to include particular structures. Most programs, for example, don't have a value for tobacco barns or sugar houses or things like that, and we can put them in here. You know, little oddities that are distinct to Conway or to maybe just a few communities. We can put in an area where we can say how many of these acres are under conservation restriction for a given property. And then I can pull a report like that that says, okay, we have this many acres townwide in APR or in conservation restriction. Patriot, for example, has nothing like that. There are no user-friendly fields that are able to be easily used by the local community. So we felt that that was one of the strengths of Tyler. And so that's planning that out. So we would ask for a warrant article to put $2,500 this year and probably each of the next 2 years into our overall conversion costs. The conversion costs would be spread over fiscal 19 and 20 and would cover basically extra hours in our office to make the conversion, to train for it, and to do the double checking.
Very thorough. Thank you, Lynn.
Yep.
Any other questions for Lynn?
Yeah, so in the piece that the software that the treasurer or the tax collector uses that this
yes.
Tyler also has
yes.
that piece as well.
They do. In fact, she's having a presentation here for a number of tax collectors to get their hands on the program and look at it so that they can make their final decision.
So will you still be splitting, like, this year part of this cost with Jan?
As I understand it, Tyler has separate charges for the collector's module and the assessor's module. And I don't believe there's an overall town charge that we would be splitting. If there is an overall charge, we would probably follow that routine,
so
yes.
$3,700,
right.
$3,775.
That's just the
assessor's
piece,
and so
right.
we don't know what the...
No, not yet. I don't know what hers would be. Yeah. And she may decide not to go with it. This program is readily adaptable with the... what's the one I keep saying? Unix, but it begins with a U, but, you know, with one that most towns use. With what the county uses for the accounting program. So if she decided to go with something else, it wouldn't be a problem technologically. We'd still be an integratable system for billing.
Okay. Thank you, Lee.
Thanks, Lee.
We're going to do Gemma next. Come on up, Gemma. Thank you, Lee. All right, Gemma, what did your budget look like?
Well, other than, I don't know how you all want to do this, whether you want me to go like line by line or...
Why don't you give us the changes?
Okay.
Everybody does have a copy of it.
Okay, cool. So the first change is just a slight increase in the hourly ambulance hourly employee salary, just our hourly rate. I just bumped that up by $904 just to, in case we get more EMTs and, you know, there being more ambulance calls. I just wanted a little bit more padding in that one.
You're not actually increasing the hourly rate, you're increasing the number of hours you might have to work.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And I think I noticed in my payroll there was a minor change in our hourly rate of a few cents. Nothing major, and I'm not aware of any changes in our hourly rate that's coming. I increased the ambulance training from $750 to $950. The membership dues for our county EMT association, which does a lot of class, they do monthly classes. For all the EMTs, that was increased a little bit, so I just bumped that up a tad to cover that, and if we get additional EMTs, then there would obviously be additional training costs for continuing it.
Right.
Is that GCC?
The EMT Association? Or?
Oh, the association does the training.
Yeah.
Oh,
there's
okay.
a Franklin County EMT Association that does monthly trainings, and then a lot of our other required Con Ed training we do through an organization in Greenfield called Community 911. They do a lot of really good classes at a fairly reasonable price. So I just increased that a little bit for that. The biggest change was in the ambulance licensing and exam costs. I based that on the potential for prepayment of EMTs to try to encourage more EMTs in town, and I bumped that from $1,000 to $7,500 based on $1,500 per EMT for five EMTs. That's obviously being extremely, it's a lot of wishful thinking going on right there. Yeah, very optimistic. But I would, you know, I'd like it available if we can pull that off.
Have you gotten any interest?
A little bit. I haven't finalized the contract and everything with Tom yet.
Okay.
We're working on that at the moment. So I'm hoping that within the next few months we'll have some kind of movement in the direction of more EMTs. I reduced the ambulance telephone and cell phone from 600 to 300. Apparently the past directors have had a separate cell phone for, right now there's a cell phone in the ambulance for our use if we need it, but I guess there was an additional cell phone for the director themselves, and I don't need or want that. I'll use my own cell phone if necessary for anything.
You're not going to have that spare phone in the ambulance?
No, the ambulance will, phone will stay in the ambulance, but that cost, I mean, it ends up being $15 a month or something. It doesn't need to be, I guess in the past there's been an additional cell phone that the director has used.
For the past years,
I think at one point.
The phone was taken out, for the ambulance was taken out, kind of through the fire department.
Right.
People with a fire chief's cell phone also. And we split the cost. Which isn't a lot of money, but
right.
That's still, I guess, the way it is right now.
Right.
Just put the cost of that.
Yeah,
I stamp my half and I send on you, you know.
Yeah, and I do the other part of it. But it really doesn't end up being very much.
It was done that way originally to try to save the town money.
Yeah.
Because by me adding one more
phone,
$14 a month more.
Right.
So. Otherwise you'd be faced with another $300-$400 charge.
Yeah, it would be ridiculous. So that it didn't need to be as high as 600. I'm not sure why it wasn't originally. And I increased our ambulance transfer and intercept fees from 7,000 to 8,000, just based on the fact that our population is aging and there are a lot more calls for needing a paramedic or advanced life support intercept. Mm-hmm. And we do have a set fee that we pay to either Northampton Fire or Medcare in Greenfield. Those are our two primary ALS intercepts that we work with, and there's a set rate for each time we call them. And I increased our other supplies account from $2,450 to $2,700 just based on the fact that supplies and medications are increasing. Mm-hmm. And there's not much we can do. The more the state legislates, the more things increase. So
okay. Basically all your other accounts remain the same.
Yep, everything else is the same. So overall, all right. It's not increased a whole lot other than, you know, the biggest difference being the license and exam costs.
Right. Yeah, that's the major part of the increase, and that of course is necessary to attract more EMTs. Okay. Any questions for Gemma?
No. There may be, but not this time.
Okay.
This sounds good.
Thanks, Gemma.
I will note that Gemma did give a detailed presentation to the select board on the need for the advanced money for training, and we do have an agreement that we're working on to have people repay that if they do not remain in the town's service after either 1 or 2 years. I'm not sure if we've nailed that one down yet, but we're very close to having that agreement finalized, and that is our protection such as it is, so we might have to go to small claims court to enforce it or something. But it'll give people an idea of the seriousness with which we're fronting the money for them to get trained.
How many EMTs do you have?
At the moment, 5.
And is that low compared to how it's been in the past?
Yes. In the past year, we lost 3 EMTs due to just no longer desiring to do it.
What do you feel, Gemma, should be the average number of EMTs for the town?
I would like to see at least 3 more active. I mean, we have 5 at the moment that are on our roster. One of them is in college, and so she's out of town quite a bit. One works. There are 2 of them that work a lot other jobs out of town, which leaves 2 in town on any kind of regular basis. So, you know, I would like to see at least three more active, you know, in-town people.
Bob, are you one of the EMTs?
I'm just a fill-in driver.
Okay.
I bail them out in the daytime. It's a great person.
I recently went to this thing called the Small Town Summit, dealing with problems of small towns, and there was a lot of talk about ambulance. And they're trying to push a bill through the legislature that would make it so you can still go on a call with one EMT and a driver. And there are towns where that's where they are. And right now they have to have two EMTs.
Yeah.
And so we're close.
Okay.
We don't want to be faced with what the alternative would be if that failed.
Yeah, right.
Because you'd be looking at many, many thousands of dollars more a year.
Yeah.
And a longer waiting period.
Yeah. You mean if we were to have to
hire
if we didn't have site. Conway ambulance, basically. Right.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. Okay.
Thank you, Gemma.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, we'll do Ron next. Go ahead, Ron.
Let's see, which one do you want to start with? The building maintenance?
Sure.
Yeah.
It's easy.
Yeah, that one's easy. Level funding that one. New to me, I'm still working on things, and at this point, I'm good with the way the budget is right now. Hopefully, by next year, we'll have a better understanding of where things are going with the building maintenance, but there definitely is needs in the buildings.
And have you started negotiating with the sheet buyer out yet?
As far as I know, we have a long term on that.
It's a 1 year contract.
Yeah,
we don't expect an increase in that.
Right.
No, but we should be signing the contract. We should be signing the extension.
Sure. Sure.
Very soon.
Okay.
We're supposed to do that in January.
Just in case somebody there was an inkling.
In January,
no. Yeah.
He likes to get it done ahead of time, which is a good thing.
No, I don't have a problem with that. When I talked to him, he said that where the money is right now is good for, he doesn't have any.
Good.
Okay. And actually, if it gets a whole lot more expensive than that, it's probably going to have to be evenized. But
there is a slight problem in signing the contract this early, which is that we actually don't have the money appropriated to cover it yet. So it's not technically legal. But
no, but you could come to an agreement what it would be.
Yeah. Well, I'll work on that.
So yeah. It's no surprise for the budget, right?
Right.
If something changes.
Oh yeah.
Okay, Ron. That's good. Level funded. All right. Next item is your highway.
Okay, my highway, I pretty much tried level of funding that, except for there's changes made in wages, the changes that I made, I took out of other items to lower them so I could level fund, with the exception of my repairs budget. And this is dependent, I've asked replace the grader that we have because it needs a transmission, and actually the estimate that I got on it is for $35,000. When I put in the $40,000, it was before I actually had a firm number.
So that's 85?
$35,000.
So instead of 90, repairs, it's 85?
Yes. So other than that, that's the only, in that, if we move forward with replacing the grader, we can go back to the $50,000.
Okay. What's this first salary increase for, Ron? I know you said how you offset somebody else to make the difference, but
the first one?
Yeah, is that's more than this year's salary? Or?
That's a current this year's salary. There's no change in that. This 2017 budget number is wrong.
Oh.
It's actually supposed, it is 61,503.
So this is the same amount.
Yeah, I made no increases in dollar amounts except for in the hourly wages. We now have a laborer that we're paying $15 an hour, and upon him receiving his hoister's license, it's planned for him to go to $16 an hour. And then I've also added an extra dollar an hour for one of the truck driver laborers for a foreman position.
And your part-time secretary's in there somewhere? Probably
there. Yeah, she's in there too. That's all. All that's included. All right, so let me go over my office worker, assistant. Her salary is, I figured, $6,240. The laborer position is $33,280. Two truck driver laborers is $83,283. And then a foreman position is $43,722, which makes up that $166,525.
Okay, questions?
How many hours on the grader?
6,200 hours.
The Capital Improvements Committee was in the midst of debating this, right. But we did not meet.
Yes, I know.
What, sir?
Yeah, I know.
Oh, okay.
So are we going to have another meeting? Nobody's heard?
For Capital Improvements?
Yeah.
I haven't heard of
it. I've asked Dana when he's planned to schedule one.
So it's still up in the air whether there'll be an article to replace the grader or an article or a transmission replacement.
Right. Okay. As far as, but I'm guessing that that's where we stand right now.
Do we want to get into this discussion at all here now, or do you want to wait for the?
Let's get capital planning involved. You know.
Okay. They should get involved in the discussion, I would think.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'll note that if we do actually decide to get the grader, that I would recommend borrowing for it.
Back to you, Ron. Yearly audit.
Other questions for Ron? All right. Thank you, Ron.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll take Jenny next.
Yeah.
Jenny, come on up.
Okay, I'm going to put out a job description. This is based on the human resources assessment that was done 2 years ago, close to 2 years ago now. My budget this year is basically an effort to set the stage for transition. It increases the clerk's salary to a level that might be expected by a person starting in the position as it is described in the job description. And it adds the position of an assistant clerk for up to 5 hours per week to assist with some of the clerk's regular office duties and to familiarize another person with some of the basic details required of the clerk's office.
That's the $4,000 item?
That's the $4,000 item. It's not setting a precedent by adding an assistant clerk. Actually, until Violet Parker became clerk, the clerk did have an assistant. They kind of took that out of the picture when the men stopped being town clerks. So it's not really adding something that was never there. It was historically there. And the other point of having an assistant clerk is that when I leave, if I leave before the next election, the selectmen will have a chance to appoint someone that could eventually run for the office, someone that would be familiar with the job. And even if that person chose to remain assistant clerk, there is a huge advantage to having someone have your back with a position like this.
Now, is that something you would advertise that position for, or is that something you have somebody in mind for?
I would have somebody in mind. It's not something that I think that, I mean, you can't really go outside of the town if you are going to have someone that is eventually going to take over the position, because the town voted to maintain it as an elected position.
And that shall be held under the statutes of Massachusetts and all the laws. It's an elected position, and that shall come up as a voted position. There is no obligation to you as a retiring clerk. You retire as a clerk, and it comes up as a position in a democracy to be voted upon. There's no reappointing of this position.
If I leave before my term is up, someone can be appointed. That's how I got the position initially.
I was
appointed.
But it should come to vote, because that's the way democracy works.
Thank you, Justice. Do you want to give us a rundown on between 17 and 18 and the salary line, and why that shouldn't?
I also wanted to mention it will be known that there is this position, and people can approach Ginny for it, but she is an elected official, and she will choose amongst the thousands of candidates who want the position, the one who she thinks will be best suited for it. That doesn't mean that we're not going to put a notice up on the bulletin board either, but it won't be in the newspaper, let's put it that way. We don't need to go to that level when we advertise part-time positions. Our personnel policy says we can do that internally. So that just a clarification on that.
Yeah, just give us the background on that salary line.
Yeah, when I proposed a raise in the town clerk's salary for last year, and that was I had mentioned it very specifically at the time, meant to be the first of two annual raises, not to make the jump in 1 year, but to spread it over 2 years. And in fact, we've come down on the amount that I was proposing. I was proposing a $7,000 increase for this year, and it's about $5,800 now. So we've come down on that. This brings Ginny up to the level which our human resources consultant proposed as what he called the benchmark level for the position, which is more or less the middle of where the pay is. There's a minimum within the range that we would develop, and a maximum within the range. The benchmark is in the middle of that. Both of those are within the possible amount that the position could have. So the normal amount is a little bit tighter, and the benchmark is right in the middle. And this would bring Ginny right up to the middle of where that position was according to the work that we had done a couple of years ago. So it's actually a little bit old. One oddity about the town clerk's position is that she works different hours depending on how many elections there are in a year. But she estimates that over the last several years, maybe 4 years anyway, she's worked an average, and she does keep good records, about 30 hours a week. Obviously, not a lot of those are not posted hours for the public to come in, because there's a lot of back-end work that the town clerk is responsible for every election, including getting the the registrars ready and getting the registration happening, and then of course supervising an election and then reporting that election to the state, and the Secretary of State. There are any number of steps that, most people don't see, as opposed to the ones where she's in her office. So this is based on at 30 hours a week, which is what she's been working. This is the benchmark or average as of 2 years ago, I'll mention.
Yeah, you did mention.
Yeah, I'll just make sure I mention it. So this is not, I think, asking for too much. It is bringing it up to a level where an entry-level person might be interested in taking it on, which is going to be, it's very important to have someone who's dedicated to the work in the town clerk's office. It's an essential function of the town. As you'll see, you know, you're looking through the job description there, and in the document I handed out, the budget document I handed out earlier, it goes also into the different areas that the town clerk's responsible for. So that's why the salary is proposed to rise.
And this is a result of a survey done by a human resources consultant who looked at all the other towns around us, looked at the salaries, and found out that our town clerk was kind of a little bit lower than she should have been in terms of the rank of the other towns. And that's why that increase is the way it is.
And that takes into account also experience and the level of responsibility, which is roughly the same for town clerks because it's very highly legislated.
Is that the original Council of Governments, is that the HR?
The Council of Governments has not taken the town clerk's salaries. Oddly enough, I looked for both last year and the year before, and neither one of them had town clerks. Wow. But again, the person that we hired to do it, you know, did look at comparables.
Mm. And who were they referred to? How did they find it? How were they referred to the town of Conway?
I'm sorry?
How was this person, this consultant, how were they referred to the town of Conway? Who did this HR survey, salary survey? How did they come to us?
This was a couple of years ago, and this was the low quoter. It was not a major bid thing. It was $5,000 to do this. He's a well-known municipal consultant among many. Others would charge double what he did for the work.
That was not just the town clerk, but all persons.
All town positions.
Oh yeah, he did the whole town. He got new job descriptions for everybody, and job classifications for people, which will be important as we move forward with the uniform compensation plan.
Which would be.
So in that 30 hours, which you have given wonderfully to this town for years and years and years, plus the off hours, is it a 40-hour week? Is it a 42-hour week? Is it for you?
It's a 30. It averages out to be a 30-hour week.
Plus what you do behind.
No, that includes that.
That includes all that.
30-hour week.
Do you have? How many hours a week do you have posted to?
I have 9 hours posted on the door. But if you.
No, this is a good question.
If you come into the office at 8 o'clock in the morning, I'm apt to be there. And if you come in at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm apt to be there.
Or at midnight on the days we vote.
Right. Yeah.
Don't okay. Laugh because there have been times in the past when I was here at midnight because somebody died and a funeral home needed a burial permit.
Right.
So it's a basically you're available 24/7. And I did take my very first vacation in 37 years last year. And I decided that I liked it.
Okay. Tom, can I ask, I got a question. Any other questions?
Yeah, I got a question.
It may be for Tom, I'm not sure. But I want to make sure I understand. So back in 2015, they did a study, and you proposed two $7,000 a year raises.
No.
So I see a $7,000 a year raise, which was to be the first increase, followed by a second increase that got turned down in the next year?
The second one was going to be a $5,000, I think, wasn't it?
That's what I'm wondering about.
The second one has come down from $7,000 to the benchmark that was there after the human resources consultant went through and did his study. When I proposed the 7 and 7, that was based on my own estimate.
Okay.
So I was only $1,500 off.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, other questions? Okay, thank you, Jenny.
Thank you. That's a lot of days right there. Thank you very much.
All right, Tom, take it away.
Let's see. What should we do? Do you want to consider the Finance Committee and Reserve Fund now, briefly, now that everybody's here? We skipped over that because there was only you and Alan here. I put them in because I thought they'd be pretty easy to handle.
All right, Finance Committee. On our $200 a year budget, do you want to discuss making the...
No, we're going to give you the $200. We'll leave it at that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I have a motion? Recommend that we leave it at 200.
Is this enough if a couple of people want to attend the meetings? Or is it enough to join the AT...
it's $50 to go to the What's New in Municipal Law down in Holyoke in the fall.
Yeah, and then there's the...
There's the eight. What is
the newbies?
New
members.
Finance forum,
that's
whatever.
That's
what he's talking about.
That's
the Holy Cross. There's one you're talking about, and then there's the one Rosenberg and some others put on.
That's free.
Yeah, I mean,
that's a free one.
We're basically just paying for the annual dues to the ATFC here, and that's the $129 that keeps popping up.
Right. So there's another $50.
Yeah, I mean, we keep some money in here in case anybody wants to go to those things. We've got one old and one new member, so there might be some interest in it.
Probably could go up to $250.
Oh, no. Go now.
If two people wanted to go to a $50 event, that's not too much to ask.
You want to stop at $100?
What's that?
You want to stop at $100?
I think so. I think we should.
If you don't use it, it comes back. So.
How about $275? How's it?
You guys think you would go to any of those?
Guys, how's $300? $300?
Good. It's all
okay. I mean, we brought it down for $300.
You realize that's going to be the most discussed article on top of the market. The lowest price always gets discussed the most.
How about reserve fund? And they went up by 50%.
A couple of years ago, it was $35,000. I remember there was a little bit of a scare because there was a possibility that we wouldn't have enough for everything that everybody wanted that was unforeseen.
There were some legal issues.
40's a good number.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. You like it?
I'm fine with it.
Good.
We'll come back to the audit.
We'll chat about the next meeting.
All
right, Tom.
So for the town administrator budget, this covers not only my salary, Lisa's salary, but all of the town office supplies, the telephone system, the copier, advertising, the town report, conferences, and things like that. Dues also. Postage for mailing out the town warrant and town report. So, my salary is currently under negotiation, so we don't have a number for that. I would beg...
You're trying to negotiate a reduction in your compensation. That should be easy.
What's your salary as we stand?
Right there. 56,270.
I don't have anything.
56,270.
I am, Lisa works 19 and a half hours a week, and I am trying to bring that up from a budgeted 15 to a budgeted $18 an hour. The last person who held that position for any length of time left for a similar job that paid $22 an hour. So we would be lucky if Lisa stayed for $18 an hour, and I'm hoping that having it at that will at least keep her for a year.
Tom, could I ask you a question? Secretarial staffs that the town has,
yeah.
All the benefits of that, do they vary all over the place, or are they pretty much uniform, price-wise, an hour?
Oh, they not only vary dollars an hour, they vary for duties and what they do. There's a lot of variation. Yes, there is a lot of variation. Again,
I wondered if that's something that we should look at in the future down the road. Or...
Well, and this, yes, oh yes, absolutely.
Some of them have been here a lot of years and they don't get paid as much money as somebody who's new walks in the door. And
that is the way it goes.
So based on that number, 52,670 a year, you're getting out of 365 days based on an 8-hour day, $18.03 an hour. Correct? Right, it's $56,000 a year?
It's not 365
no.
days.
Right, of course it's
not. I was talking about Lisa now.
Yeah,
very right.
Okay. I'm just having to check.
He's wiring by 2,000 hours or something.
Okay, so yeah. You want to raise Lisa up to what?
$18 an hour, right. Okay. Oh, which is actually what she's getting now because we spent so long without someone. Hard to get somebody for the position that we actually have extra in the budget. And when I did hire her, I did mention this to the select board, so they are aware of the plan to ask for this raise, and went along with paying her the $18 an hour for the remainder of fiscal year 17. For mileage, I'm. Yeah, I'm tracking my real mileage, and it's going to go over $600 this year. I do expect to pay some of it myself. I'm not asking for more than I use, certainly for mileage. And the same with dues and conferences, just below there. Postage, no, we didn't quite use the $1,300 last year. I'm bringing it down to $1,200. That a lot of that depends on how many special town meetings we have. If we have, it's somewhere around $250 per special town meeting. So that's where the variation in that comes in, because we have to send out warrants to everybody in the mail. So that's what causes the variation in that. The telephone is going up here. And I'm hoping that the cost is actually slated to go down over time. And I may revise this figure when I come out with my the full preliminary budget, because we have just changed over as of yesterday and the day before and some today and some on Friday. We're changing over to a new supplier, so I believe that figure is actually going to come down, but I do have to do the math on it. I do want to include in the budget two telephones themselves, the units, in case we have a problem. We had actually three phones go out. They were old phones. What's old these days? 5 years? It was ridiculous to have a 5-year telephone break down. And of course, they're all so complex and digital that it's not like you can go in and rewire. So we actually had to buy three phones this year. That includes installing them. They come with software. It's kind of extraordinary. So I will keep that cost in. So there will be some added cost, which may eat up the savings at this time, but at least once we have some stability in the hardware, I can't tell you what it was like to go for three people to go without phones for multiple days. We also had
Bob couldn't bring his own cord, bring the corded phone down.
He must have been quiet.
The rotary.
Yeah, it was. So, anyway.
So is this a one-time charge? He's adding by two new phones for backup, or?
Yes. Yes.
I wonder if these should be in the capital plan.
Yeah,
not that enough. Expensive.
Not big enough.
What does a phone run?
$250, yeah, I think. And the...
Is this an iPhone, or is it a...
It's desk phone.
Desk office phone. Phone.
Desk phone.
Just an office phone? $250 for an office phone?
That's
well,
what,
again,
that's,
it
that's
includes...
That's what we paid for them.
Right. Yeah. So
the cost will be different. This
yeah. Copier, I'm bringing that down a couple of $100s because we have a really good maintenance agreement, and we haven't needed to spend nearly as much as we did before we switched over to Baker. We were using CBS out of Connecticut, and they have poor service and they were expensive, and now we've got Baker's from Greenfield and they have really good service and they're much less expensive. So I'm bringing that down a little. Advertising, I hope we don't have to do as much advertising as we have in the past. This is for jobs, that really, or any legal ad that we have to put in. So that's coming down. Town report is going up because we under budgeted. You can see the expense in fiscal year 2016 was almost $3,500. So I'm putting in $3,600 just to have a little bit in case costs go up for that. Supplies, we went substantially over for all of the past 3 years. I think it's been tremendously under budget. We've been making up a deficit. The town report used to be under supplies. And, you know, it cost $3,500. They took it out of supplies and then never put anything else back into supplies as we were adding people, adding, you know, we needed more in supply. So that's back up to it's up to $3,000 now after having spent $4,600 on supplies, then $58.
But that was including the town report?
No, not since
14.
Right? I think even
was it 16?
Before. No. Yes, the town report, you can see where it says not applicable.
Yeah.
So that came in. You can see the $3,000 came out of that and it left only $2,000 in instead of another $800 that ought to have been in there.
Yeah.
So, and then we spent a lot for some reason in 2016. I know some of that was computer supplies. We didn't have it all under, we didn't have IT at that point. Right. So IT came in 2017.
Look at your computers.
All the IT was under office supplies until last year, and now we have a whole internet thing. So that's...
But it says in 2016 we actually spent $8,000 between the town report and the supplies.
Yeah, yes, but they're two separate. They're two separate items now, so we can track them independently.
So that included some new computers.
And as I said last year, I'd like to keep a little bit more in professional and technical services because I was a little bit leery of creating a new IT function and how that was going to work. It's actually worked really well. And so I want to bring that item down from $3,700 to $1,000. And that would still be used. One of the things I have to do is test the water. I go out with some bleach and play with faucets and take samples down to, you know, Hatfield and have them tested. I have to do that annually according to the Board of Health. So that sort of thing is a professional technical service. That's just an example. But if I had to get anything done that was like that, that's why I left that. Now, maybe that'll come down again next year. Again, I don't want to take it down too much. and not be able to fulfill my responsibilities. But at least I brought it down $2,700 this year. So.
Okay. Any questions for Tom?
It says the internet's been transferred to item number 159. What's that?
Yeah, it's 159, and that's expected to be level funded. That was in that long list of level funded items I handed out the last time we met,
okay, yeah,
together with the finance committee.
It's a 29% increase on what you want, $1,000 and $3,500 from last year.
For legal, I'm proposing level funding based on current year's expenses. We're now up to about $6,500, and we're just past halfway through the year. Mm-hmm. So I think $10,000 will be realistic.
And what was the budget for last year?
$10,000. I am proposing a rise in the dog, the animal control officer's budget. It was traditionally called the dog officer. A couple years ago, a year and a half ago, there was legislation in Boston that said we need to have all the dog officers under this umbrella of animal control officer, and there's a whole bunch of new laws and regulations, and they give out badges now. They're sworn officers of the Commonwealth. Often they're police officers.
Dog something to bite on.
Yeah. There you go. There is a major increase in salary here, and that is something. The area dog officers get a lot more than ours does, and this is again a kind of a tranche. We'll see if we need to bring it up any more next year. It could go up to $2,000, but there $2,000 or $3,000 a year is common for animal control officers. If you do it by hour, it's below minimum wage, because he does get a lot of calls, especially in the spring when people are letting their dogs out and running around. And it's there's more activity than you might think.
And you looked at you looked at the FERCOG survey for that.
Yeah, yeah, and it's okay. This is not unreasonable for his position, but again, that was for fiscal year 16, and we're talking about fiscal year 18. So I'll look at fiscal year 17 again and see if it needs to be slightly adjusted higher. Also,
it works out to be $5.50 a day.
Are they involved in when there's rabid animals?
That's a different. It's the same guy, yeah. Joe Colucci, but in that instance, he's acting as the animal inspector, which is a state appointed position. Recommended by our Board of Health. So a related but separate position.
But he's involved in taking samples and sending them off to Boston or whatever?
He wouldn't take the samples. He enforces a quarantine of any dog that bites a human. And I don't know, maybe he bites another dog.
Wildlife
comes under the animal control law. Wild animals. To get rid of that bat, we could call Joe.
What about snakes?
Nothing.
Snakes?
We're talking about rabies right now.
Any wild animal comes under the animal control officer. The animal inspector is sometimes also called a barn inspector, and the position is mainly for inspecting agricultural animals and their living conditions, including the barn, and its barn inspector. But that's in the Board of Health's budget.
And they won't act
this,
on rabies.
This $1,600 also includes the cost of annual training, which he's required to do. He's required to do 3 days of annual training that the state puts out. Now, it's funded by the state, but it's time and mileage, and it was awkward last year because he gets a stipend, paid in the lump sum, but he felt as though he were working lots of hours, which he was, and so this is also partly to compensate him for working those hours that he has to during that long mandated state training for which there is no cost, but there's also no reimbursement for time. The kennel expenses straight. The training, the hourly training has gone down from 600 to 100 because the training is now included in that $1,600 salary. With any additional training that might actually cost money, we just left $100 in there in case there's something that comes along that he thinks he wants to take. Equipment, $100, he pretty much has all the equipment he needs at this point, but he might need to, you know, if something breaks, he might need to get a new one, so that's just $100 placeholder in case he needs something. So the overall budget goes up $650 to $2,650.
Okay.
The tree warden slated to go up from $375 to $585. That's extra money that's required for membership as a municipality in the Massachusetts Tree Wardens and Foresters Association.
So Walter wants a raise.
And he should be a municipal member. The membership as an individual is $75, but if you want to be a municipal member, they ask for more, and we should give them what it takes to run their association.
Okay, that's it.
So how much was it for the tree warden? You got X amount of money for training and all that stuff for getting into the association?
$235.
Plus the initial...
Plus $300 stipend,
right.
And $50 in mileage. Mm. And that's enough to get to Central Mass and back.
That's not. That's not.
Which is where the conference was this year, so I threw it in.
Well, we see the status of our trees along the main streets and the woodlands, so.
Okay, any other questions on budgets? Okay.
Do we have anything on the fire department and inspections of local municipalities, fire protection?
We covered the fire department, police department, and emergency management in the last meeting that we had between the two groups, but I'd be happy to talk with you about it if you give me a call at the office or shoot me an email or drop by.
I'm looking around, I don't see any fire extinguishers here. I duly noted at the Congregational Church, which we spent $250,000 on, there are no fire extinguishers whatsoever through that building.
You must have stolen them.
Oh, yeah, I stole them. We'll go on tour tomorrow with that. Also, the...
If you have comments like that, if you can let me know.
Right, I missed last week's reading, but I just noticed this because I cleared up for this weekend.
Yeah, shoot me a line. I've written comments are the best because I can...
Right.
Things from minute to
right.
minute.
But think,
if you drop by, I'll write it down myself.
You can slate it that we need to do a little more thorough inspections.
We'll be happy to pass that along to the fire chief.
All right. Thank you. Do you know who the fire chief is in this town?
No.
Okay, good.
Never heard of it.
I'll pass that along to him, and I'll make sure that I'll slate it for next week's meeting, and I'll be front and center at 7 o'clock.
Well, it might not rise to the level of select board attention.
That's fine. If it doesn't reach that, there's other alternative measures that we can go to. But duly noted, at this meeting, there is no fire protection at the Congregational Church. There are no fire.
It would be helped very much to get this over when I'm over at the office and write an email, phone call, anything.
I'll be in.
Okay.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Justice.
Thank you.
Okay, next item, mail.
Yes.
Tom, did you see this?
Yes.
This Religious Land Use and Institutionalized Persons Act. Would you discuss this with the chief?
Yes, sure. This is I think it's just raising awareness among towns of people's civil rights.
Right, right. We'll leave it at that. Okay, and this is...
I encourage you to read this because it raises your awareness of people's civil rights.
Can you put copies in a mailbox? Tom?
Was there a copy of that in our packet?
No.
No, it's in the mail.
It's in the
mail. Always read the mail. You should always read
the mail. Put a copy in our mailbox, would you please?
Sure.
Somebody can have it.
This one.
Yeah.
That's the same one. Oh, no.
No.
That's a thank you. That's a good one.
This is a thank you to...
Especially the police chief and fire chief.
Great, glad you left. Come back here.
Yeah, where's that reporter when you need him?
Okay, this is from the Boston. This is from the Boston Globe. Tom?
I'm sorry?
The Boston Globe.
Regional and night desk copy editor of the Boston Globe was out hiking with a friend, and his friend had some problems. He suffers from mild dementia, and he was getting hypothermic, and they needed some help. They came out on the wrong end of the trail they were on, didn't know where they were, and needed emergency help.
Here in Conway?
And they sent in some a very full letter of gratitude, especially to the police chief and fire chief, and I have passed that along to them as requested by the fellow.
Good. Okay. Any other announcements? No announcements. Okay. Next meeting will be Monday, February 6th at 6 o'clock here in the town hall for more budget work, right?
Okay.
And we are going to have an executive session under reason two, conduct negotiating sessions with non-union personnel, and we will adjourn from that session. We're going to hold it over in the town office. I'll make a motion that we go into executive session. Do I have a one?
Aye.
Vote?
Aye.
Vote? Aye. Okay. We'll do that over in the town office.